Good evening. This lecture, בעזרת השם, will be לרפואת בבי יודיק יהושע בן שפרה, אברהם בן סימה, אורי בן דיקלה, מזל בת רינה, אליאנה ליאל בת יוכבד, יואל בן גיטל, יעקב רובן בן הייקה, אברהם שלמה בן מזל אסתר. And also, ללידה קלה ותינוק בריא of Angela Allegria בת דינה. And אברהם חיים בנימין בן חוגלה, שיהיה לו בעזרת השם בית במהרה בירושלים, עיר הקודש. And for the success and פרנסה טובה and רפואה and אושר of מסעודה בת ברכה. We are getting closer to Rosh Hashanah, getting very scary to be honest with you, especially after the last Rosh Hashanah, that we had so many bad decrees on us, as you can all see. We are getting very close, that's it, Rosh Hashanah is almost here. Next week, we will have a lecture. בעזרת השם. This week I'm going to Montreal, Wednesday and Thursday. We'll be on 4 lectures over there. I'm trying to get a few more lectures just before the end of the year. Please look at my schedule because after Yom Kippur, we have a break until after Sukkot, which is 2 or 3 weeks. We have to see in the calendar. I don't know if you're following the news, but today was the most powerful day in a war in the last year, in Lebanon. They killed more than 500 terrorists today. They didn't kill 400 the entire year. Today alone, they killed more than they killed the entire year. Finally, the Israelis decided to do the war in the right way, not like cowards. Till now it was like cowards. Houses are being bombed, 150 missiles every day falling on citizens, residents, on children, on women, blowing up houses, roof is going on fire, people live in fear, in panic attack. 11 months, 11 and a half months, 11 months. The government barely did anything. Few attacks here and there, they don't care. Today they started, the last week they started to feel what Israel can do to them. It was up to me, it would be 100 times worse. I would not leave one of them alive with no mercy. You're not allowed to have mercy on such Nazis. Everyone who have Nazi, everyone who have mercy on people that murder children and civilians, they're not fighting soldiers, they're fighting civilians, they're shooting rockets at civilians. Places that shoot rockets in another place, you have to wipe them all out. You don't leave one alive. You tell the citizen, run for your life. We have nothing to do with you, the Lebanese. Fight, run. We will fight these Nazis until not one of them will stay alive. Doesn't matter how many there are. You can kill them all. You have the ability to do it. Now it started. So that means that the war with Hamas is dying out. But with them just starting now. It may take another year, we don't know. We will see on Rosh Hashanah, this coming Rosh Hashanah, what Hashem would write. Maybe it was written in last Rosh Hashanah that we will finish with them between now and Rosh Hashanah. Maybe it will be a 2 weeks war. Maybe they will surrender. The ego of these Arabs, it's so high that they would rather all die with their women, with their children, and they will not surrender. A normal person, when he see he lose, and more people dying, and more dying, he say, okay, enough, okay, let's go in a ceasefire. We won't bother you anymore. Why? At least we save whoever we can, but they don't care. They don't care, you kill another 1,000. What's his name? Nasrallah doesn't care. I mean, all these people who in Hezbollah, they're all mercenaries. They get a salary, it's not... We're not talking about ideology here. The only ideology is to murder Jews. That's what unites all Arabs in the world. Shiites, Sunnis, as much as they hate each other, but when it comes to kill Jews, they agree on one thing. There's only one thing they agree with. How many Jews we can kill, the more the better. But anything else, they're against each other. They kill each other, they rape each other, they murder each other from over 1,000 years. It doesn't start today. The Shiites and the Sunnis, they hate each other in the highest level of hate. Throughout history, they kill each other. But when it comes to Israel, they're willing to tolerate and cooperate with each other because their hatred to the Jews is so high that for the time being, it puts their hatred to each other on hold. That's why Hamas is supporting Hamas and going with Iran. Since when? Shiites and Sunnis supporting each other, helping each other, training each other. There's one thing unites them. What? Killing Jews. And who gives them this order to fight the Jews? The answer is Hashem. And anybody who doesn't understand that, unfortunately, is an heretic. All the suffering we had from day one until today, from the Nazis, from the Arabs, from the Europeans, from all over the world, Iran, it was all written by Hashem. Hashem have switches, one switch called Iran, one switch called Russia, one switch Syria, one Hamas, Jihad, there's a lot of switches. And Hashem has like a volume button. Sometimes it's on 25%, sometimes he raises it to 50%. Exactly as I tell you. Sometimes he raises October 7, he raises it to 100% for a day or two. He's playing with that according to the consequences of our action. For instance, if there's a lot of Torah, a lot of Tehillim, the volume button goes lower. That means instead of 150 missiles, tomorrow it's going to be 40. It's updated every minute. Every minute. If a teacher comes in yeshiva, children, let's all read Tehillim and scream to Hashem for mercy. This alone can save the life of dozens of people. The more people we save, the more Baalei Tshuva we make. Every Baal Tshuva, one Jew that was Mechalel Shabbat and became now Shomer Shabbat, that alone can save the situation. The value of one soul that you save is beyond what you can even imagine. It's written in the Gemara. Kol ha-matzil nefesh achat mi-Israel ke'ilu etzil olam umlo'o. If you save the soul of one person from the nation of Israel, soul of one, it's like you save the entire world in the eyes of Hashem. And if one Jew is going off the path, meaning he was very religious, grew up religious, went to yeshivas, and now he's starting to go off. It's count like milchemet Gog u'Magog. If a father have a child that is going off the path, starting to become less and less religious, this is a tragedy that is equal. Actually, it's worse, not equal. The Gemara says, yoter garua, it's worse. And then milchemet Gog u'Magog. Than the final war that will finish up the world, which we are very close to. So, Milchemet Gog u'Magog, you know, the final war, that everyone is shaking from it. All the prophets talked about it. The Holy Zohar spoke about it. It's crazy. Just to lose one soul, or to save one soul, has a very massive, heavy weight in the eyes of Hashem. Because remember, one person alone can learn in yeshiva, can go into yeshiva and sit and learn 10, 12 hours a day, and can make 600,000 to 800,000 mitzvot a day. About 1 million secular Jews, do not do it in a day, a million. Million secular Jews, the entire secular people of Tel Aviv, all together do not reach 800,000 mitzvot a day. Just for you to give you the comparison here. One guy from Tel Aviv, you made him Shomer Shabbat, he watched the film, and decided to stop with his nonsense, and he went to yeshiva, and he's sitting now 10, 12 hours a day in learning Torah. Each letter that comes out of his mouth is mitzvah from the Torah. How many mitzvot the people of Tel Aviv keep? At best case scenario, if they do one mitzvah a day, I'll be surprised. I have a million secular people, most of them haters of Hashem, many gays, many psychos, many people who change their identity, if you know what I mean. Men that dress like women, women that dress like men. Lots of wackos there. Lots of wackos. You would need 500,000 psychiatrists to work in Tel Aviv alone. Every one of them would have a full-time job. Why? It becomes the most corrupted, most wicked city in the world. I told you what happened 10 days ago there. The entire shore of Tel Aviv became all black. Like tar, you know the tar that they put on the roof of the buildings to avoid water leaks? The entire water, usually it's the cleanest water in the world, the beaches in Israel. It's such pure water, you can look in the bottom, if you throw a quarter, you see the quarter standing outside of the water, you look down, it's 4 or 5 feet deep, you can see the quarter clearly. That's how clear the water usually. You know, if you go to the Hudson River, you cannot see anything. You put your hand inside, just a little bit below the water, you can't see anything, it's all mud. But the water in Israel usually is very, very clean. The Mediterranean Ocean, you know, it's very clean. But the water of Tel Aviv was black, with lots of dead rats and dead birds. Something happened, Hashem like blew up the sewer or something. For a few days, nobody could enter the water. Where do you see things like this happens in the world? Everything that happens around us, it's a signal from Hashem to every one of us. Not only to the people of Tel Aviv, for everyone in the world. Everyone in the world. If you have an earthquake in China and 80,000 people died, or even 10,000 people, it's a sign for us, the nation of Israel, to open up our eyes. Now today there was an earthquake in Japan again. Every year they almost have one, 5.5, it's not as massive as the previous one that destroyed large cities of Japan, but it's also, it makes cracks in the buildings, it ruins the foundations of the buildings, and now they have a threat for tsunami. Remember the last tsunami killed 500,000 people. God forbid, if there will be something like this in the beach of Tel Aviv, tsunami would come, it will kill 1 million people in Tel Aviv. One big wave of water can cover the whole city of Tel Aviv. It can happen. In fact, it didn't happen, doesn't mean it cannot happen. It happened to the Goyim, it happens in Thailand, in all these places. So, Rabotai, situation is not good. We hopefully, maybe after all the suffering we had this year, that maybe Hashem will ease the judgment on us on Rosh Hashanah that comes. I hope people will be more responsible this year and will take the prayers more serious, and the tshuva, which is the most important thing, the tshuva, the repentance, to take it very, very serious. Everyone has something to improve with. If it's Shabbat, if it's the modesty, the way the woman dressed, if it's what he's watching, what he's listening to, how they conduct business. There are people that are God-fearing people. You can see from every transaction, they have a doubt in the business. It's allowed, not allowed. They're willing to give up a lot of money. They call the rabbi, "Rabbi, this is the case. The customer is a Jew. I'm afraid maybe it's interest. I didn't know he's a Jew." You know, with a non-Jew, you can pay interest, you can charge interest. But with your brothers, the Torah says, not allowed. You cannot charge interest, and you cannot collect interest. Sometimes the person, on the last minute, he found out, wow, I didn't know, the person has a non-Jewish name. All of a sudden, he found out his mother is Jewish. What should I do? Should I do the deal? Not. You see that people are willing sometimes to give out tens of thousands of dollars profit in a deal, not to violate one rule of the Torah. Then on the other hand, you have the people that don't care about anything. They may walk with a yarmulke. Maybe the yarmulke is for the beauty, I don't know. You know, there's no connection between them and religion. You have a few of them in the Knesset. few of them that has a little yarmulke on their head. You look at the way they live, worse than any secular person. You wonder to yourself, what is the point of putting a yarmulke on your head when you have zero intention to keep anything? Usually people that keep, some of them do not want to put a yarmulke on. You have a lot of people that keep Shabbat, keep Kashrut, come to shul three times a day, and they don't walk in the street with yarmulke. They have tzitzit under the clothes, kippah they don't put. Business, different reasons. Excuses, maybe they're embarrassed. Maybe it's afraid customers won't come because they are anti-Semites. All kinds of reasons. But someone that doesn't keep anything, is mechalel Shabbat, eat everywhere, order food into his house from a non-kosher restaurant, and walks with a yarmulke, it's hard to believe. Why would a person do such thing? I mean, I understand, I know someone that opened women clothing in Bnei Brak, and he's not religious, but all day he walked with a yarmulke, because if the people in Bnei Brak would know it's mechalel Shabbat, no one would buy from him. In the heart of the religious neighborhood over there. Nobody will come to a store that owns by a person that behaves like a non-Jew. So he walks with a kippah. We understand, it's all fake. He doesn't want to lose customers. This, we have an excuse. But someone else, what reason they have to put their kippah on? Do you know how many thousands of people like this you have here in America and in Israel that walks with a kippah and it brings nothing but shame? Nothing but Shem, because the way of their behavior is every minute is Chilul Hashem. Actually, the kippah on their head make their punishment a million times harder. No exaggeration. A million times harder. Why? Because let's see if you scream and curse a goy and you don't have a kippah on the road, on the highway. Curse him, you cut him on the road, you know, can you behave like a monster? He doesn't know you're Jewish. There's no Chilul Hashem. He doesn't know who you are. He thinks you are Italian, German, whatever, American. But if he sees you with the yarmulke, he immediately understands you're Jewish. That becomes Chilul Hashem. Then he goes, he tells his friends, his brothers, his neighbors. He goes to thousands of people. He may even film you, and he's going to put it on his Facebook page or WhatsApp group. I don't know. People see you with the kippah. It becomes a massive Chilul Hashem. So what good the kippah did to you? If you put kippah because you keep mitzvah, okay, very good. That's the halacha. But if you don't keep, what's the point of putting it? Now people see you mechalel Shabbat, they see you entering restaurants that are not kosher, they see this kippah, and people curse people like you and the fakers of the religion. That's what's happening. Rabotai, on Shabbat, we read Parashat Ki Tavo. That's the scariest parasha of the entire Torah. That's the parasha that everyone is scared of. So scared that Aliyat Shishi, the sixth person who goes up to the Torah, nobody wants to go up. Nobody wants to go up. So who do they give the Aliyah to? To the one who anyway reads in the Torah. Why? Anyway is reading, they make the bracha. He has to read anyway. But nobody wants to go up. Why? All the curses in my shift? How many curses? 98 curses. That's besides the curses that appears in Parashat Bechukotai, another 49. What's the difference between the curses of Parashat Bechukotai, 49 of them, to the 98 curses of Parashat Ki Tavo? The language is different. In Parashat Bechukotai, Hashem is talking to the public. Im Bechukotai Telechu, plural. He's talking to the whole nation. If you follow my laws and you keep my commandments, I will give peace in the land, your enemies cannot affect you, you will be greater than them, and many other blessings and curses. But it's all in plural language. Telchu, tishmeru, that means when you talk to the public. In Parashat Ki Tavo, it's in a language of an individual, it's single language. V'aya ki tavo el haaretz. It doesn't say v'aya ki tavo el haaretz. What does he talks about? To the individual. So why does the Torah have to come one time and speak to the public and one time to the individual? That we have a rule that when lots of Jews, they practice a good deed together, even if they are not so righteous, the fact that they're all united right now and praying together or learning together or reading Tehillim together, the mitzvah goes express with no obstacle. Why? Because it's mitzvah that is, there are more than 10 Jews are in one place, minyan. But when the individual does something, he prays, he begs, the individual by himself, it's much, much harder for his prayer to be accepted. Why? Because the Satan, which is the prosecutor, is constantly object. Constantly. You begin to pray, please, God, enough is enough. My life is a nightmare. I can't take this anymore. I need to get married already. How many more years I'm going to suffer? Immediately the Satan object. Objection. You know how they scream in the court. Objection, Your Honor. Overrule. What does it mean, object? What is he object? How can he be a husband? Look at him. How can she be a wife? Look how she dresses. Look how she talks. Look how she behaves on social media. Immediately, he puts like a stick in the wheels of the bike. Can't drive. But when it's a massive amount, the more the better. Berov amadrat melech. That's honoring Hashem in public. The prayer goes express. That's the power of praying in minyan, in a synagogue. To all these Jews who pray alone, putting the tefillin alone in a house. Women don't need minyan. It's very nice if they join the minyan. Don't get me wrong. If she's a single girl or a mother that already her kids are older, she doesn't have babies. Very good to come to the shul. Of course, wonderful. She can get a speech, she can hear the reading of the Torah. Praying together with the public, it's very good for a woman. But she has no obligation. Why? Because the priority of a Jewish woman is to be the captain of the house. Like a captain of a boat, she is the captain of the house. She runs the show, she takes care of the kid, she watches the kid, she is cooking, she is in charge of the cleaning. She doesn't have to do it herself. She has to be in charge. She can have a maid, she can have a babysitter, but she has to supervise what's going on in the house. That's one of the main things in her life. So Hashem did not create women to be a Navy SEAL, to go fight in Baghdad, the terrorist over there, even though the Americans like to believe that that's the purpose of a woman. That's not the purpose of a woman. The purpose of a woman is different than the feminist world. The feminist world wants to do everything the opposite of what it's supposed to be. Men become women, women become men. It destroys the world, it destroys the nation, it destroys the army. Not that women cannot be strong physically. Some women are very strong. Give you one punch, you won't wake up a month. There are some, very strong women in the world. One out of 100, one out of 1,000 is very powerful. Just like a man, it doesn't matter. The psychology of a woman, the mentality of a woman is different. Doesn't mean she can be very strong in her physicality. But the mentality of a woman and the way she thinks and the way her heart reacts to things is different than a man. Plus, Hashem doesn't want the dignity of a woman to be disgraced in public. That's why women are not called to be a witness in a trial. Why? Because the cross-examination will tear her apart. It's going to bring all kinds of dirty things about her, and everybody will hear about it. This is something that cannot be tolerated. That a daughter of Hashem will be on the stand, and they will put her down, and they will show other things that she does behind the scene. It's not even an option for something like this. Also, women are acting from their hearts. So no matter what kind of a monster they have to testify against, if they're going to see the wife of that monster and the children are crying in the audience and they're going like this, immediately it will break her heart and she may change the testimony. Why? Because she cannot take the pain of seeing the wife is crying and the parents. Why they have to suffer? They have such a monster husband or father. You understand? So Hashem knows. Hashem created a man in one way, created a woman in a different way. Women, for instance, they would like to describe one scene in 3 hours with so much details and enthusiasm and describing everything in with so many details. If you ask the man what happened there, in 2 sentences he would say, and he has no patience to elaborate. Different. She talks and talks and talks. He answers 1 or 2 words, and that's the conversation. That's all you have to tell me. It's nothing personal. He just doesn't want to have a 3-hour conversation right now. So it's different mentality, different way of functioning, and that's the way it is. So going back to the Parasha Ki Tavor, people are afraid to go up to the Torah because they have superstitious beliefs that if I go up when they read the 98 curses, some of it may come on me, which is total nonsense. It's total nonsense. Nobody can be harmed by reading a part of the Torah. Doesn't matter which part, whether you read the Ten Commandments, whether you read the curses, whether you read the genealogy of Esav, or the genealogy of Ishmael, or all the kings of the Goyim, which is supposedly, what is it relevant to me to know who was the generals of the Goyim in a war? How is it called Torah? Who cares how many children Esav had? Anyway, we don't know them today by their names. Today it's a different world. Doesn't matter. Every word of the Torah, regardless of the meaning of the word, is equal in its holiness. And there are many secrets in the Torah that we're not even aware of. When the time will come, we will understand how many divine secrets are in the Torah. For instance, in the last 30 years, we discovered millions of secrets that are hidden in the Torah thanks to the creation of computer. We couldn't see that before. A regular eye of a human being cannot see what the eye of a computer can see. Then the fast speed that a computer can scan the Torah and find all kinds of combination, what the computer does in 1 second, a person may take him 20 years. Literally. If it works from morning to night, 20 years to count, and make himself notes and try again and again until he will discover hidden codes in the Torah, 20 years, the computer find it in 1 second. Nothing to compare. Once they invented the codes in the Torah and they're starting to find all kinds of events, they are shocked. There are events that are happening in our days that are written in the Torah in equal mathematical skip. Equal minimal. Remember the word minimal. Equal minimal mathematical skips. Many people are mistaken because they avoid the word minimal. So they say equal skips. Equal skips you can find randomly in many books that are thick like the Torah. You have hundreds of thousands of letters. You're going to find all kinds of combination randomly. This word, that word. Why? It could be a skip of 10,000 letters, 20,000 skip. You put a word. It's very possible the word has 4 letters. That these 4 letters appear somewhere in a Torah in equal mathematical skip, but it's very large. It can be thousands of letters between one to another. But that's random. That's nothing. There's no significance. We don't tell the computer to find us any code. No. Only minimal codes. This you don't have in any other books. You have it only in the Torah. What does it mean, minimal? Minimal means that if the computer found the word 5 times in the Torah in equal mathematical skip, it will only tell me the smallest skip. For instance, 49 letters between one letter to another, that's a small skip. It can be 21 letters, it can be 7 letters. But if he has 11,000 letters skip, no, I'm not interested in it. I know it's random. Why minimal it's not random? Because it's concentrate in one area of the Torah, like in half a page. Then when you put other words that relates to that, like for instance, you put a person and you put the person that murdered him. For instance, you enter to the Torah, Yitzhak Rabin. Yitzhak has four letters. Rabin has four letters. That's together eight letters. The computer will search the whole Torah and find it somewhere in the Torah in small skip, meaning you can see it in one page. Okay? Now you put the name of the person that killed him. What's his name? Yigal Amir. The computer will search Yigal, it's four letters. Amir, it's four letters. Also eight letters. You look for Yigal Amir, the computer find only the smallest skip. If it appear four or five times, I don't care. It only gives me the smallest skip. Because the smaller the skip is, the closer the word is. It's in one page. It's not going to be one letter in this parasha, another letter in the next parasha, another letter in the next parasha. That's random. I want it all to be in one page, that I can see all the codes in front of my eyes, and I know that it was directed by Hashem, that it's not random. So when I put Yigal Amir, the computer finds his name in the same page like Yitzhak Rabin. Same page, but not just the same page. They have a mutual resh. There is no two resh. Rabin and Amir, both of them have resh. The resh of Rabin is the resh of Amir. They cross with each other. It's unbelievable. Not only the Torah knew that Yitzhak Rabin will be killed by Yigal Amir, it's also put it in the same area in the Torah and made a mutual resh between these two individuals to show you there is a connection between them. This is definitely not random. I'll give you another example. You want to find information about the Rambam in the Torah. The Rambam lived 2,400 years after the Torah was given to the Jewish nation. So when the Torah was given to the Jewish nation in Mount Sinai, there was no Rambam in the world. He will be born 2,300 and something years after. But inside the Torah, all in one page in Parashat Bo, there is a lot of information about the Rambam. For instance, his name was Rambam, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, abbreviation Resh Mem Bet Mem. In the whole Torah, you don't have four words that are in this right order. Resh Mem Bet Mem. Only here, in Parashat Bo, you find Rebot Moftai Be'eretz Mitzrayim. Rebot start with Resh, Moftai start with Mem, Be'eretz start with Bet, and Mitzrayim start with Mem, Rambam. Then you see the word Mitzrayim. Then you see Lev Paro, he was the doctor of the king of Egypt. And then what do you see? You see in equal mathematical skip the words Mishneh and the word Torah. Mishneh, Mem, 49 letters. Shin, 49 letters. Nun, 49 letters. Hey, Mishneh. You go back down to the bottom of the page, you find Torah, Taf, 49 letters. Vav, 49 letters. Resh, 49 letters. Hey. Why there is a larger skip between Mishneh and Torah? It's one name. The name of the Rambam's book is Mishneh Torah. You have it right here on the shelf. Mishneh Torah. Right? Mishneh Torah should have been all the same skip. No. But Hashem also wanted to put in the Torah the subject of the book Mishneh Torah. What is this going to talk about? The 613 commandments. That's how the book begins. The Rambam take all the 613 commandments and begin to explain one by one. And how many letters skip you have between Mishneh and Torah? 613 letters. Have to be a huge fool not to see that it's all divine. Not fool, a huge fool. The biggest fool on earth to see such a proof and to ignore it. I remember first time when I saw it, my hands were shaking. For me, there was already no doubt whatsoever. I already remember, I thought to myself, there's nothing to check after this. Everything the rabbi will tell me, I believe, from this moment on. Why? That's it. One solid proof like this. It's enough. You don't need more than that, because the odds that something like this will happen randomly, it does not exist, statistically, does not exist. Even 1 to 1 billion, it cannot be. 1 to 1 billion, you can win the lottery 50 times in a row, that's more likely to happen than something like this will happen in a book randomly. No exaggeration what I just said. 50 times in a row, you buy a lottery ticket, 2 days later again, and again, and again, and you win all of them. What are the odds? Anyone would believe such a story? Someone came to you and said, I won the lottery 50 times in a row in a period of 2 months. Nah, get out of here, you're hallucinating. No one would even waste another minute. I think this person is crazy, it's not normal. No chance. If I throw a little dime in the ocean, and I tell you, I'll give you $1 million if you find me my dime. Would you go on a trip to look for it? Only a fool will, because there's no chance. There is a higher chance to find that dime than that something like this will be in a book randomly. First of all, who could know that there will be a Rambam in 2,400 years? Who? You need to know the future. Who would know that the Rambam would write a book, Mishneh Torah? Who would know that his nickname will be Rambam? His name was Moshe ben Maimon. But everybody called him Rambam until today. Who would know that there would be 4 letters, Resh, Mem, Bet, Mem? Who would know that he will write a book called Mishneh Torah that is going to speak about the 613 commandments and put all of this information in half a page in the Torah? 2,400 years before the Rambam was even born. What are the odds? They don't exist. So if you're clever and you see something like this in the Torah, and right next to it, it says you have to dress fully modest if you're a woman, and you have to be fully Shomer Shabbos, and to eat strictly kosher, not half enough. Strictly, make sure you don't take risk what you put in your mouth. Why? It creates the blood. The blood goes into the brain. That's where the soul is. The soul stays in the body thanks to the blood. Ki adam hu nefesh. If all the blood will spill out, the soul must separate from the body. What keeps the soul in the body? The blood. What creates the blood? The food. If the food is impure, meaning it was created from a horse that you ate, or pork, or shrimps, or things that Hashem said, don't dare to touch it, don't eat it, you have a red blood. A blood of a Russian Cossack and a blood of a Jew looks exactly the same in a lab. No one would tell the difference between the blood, this is a blood, this is human blood, and this is human blood. They can tell the difference between human blood to animal's blood, yes. But they cannot tell the difference between a blood of a Jew to a blood of a non-Jew. Why? Blood is blood. And it creates from food, any kinds of food. Even if you only eat bread all your life, nothing else, your blood will still be red. However, you know, in the blood there is iron and sugar and vitamins and all kinds of other things. Even though it's the same blood and looks the same, smells the same, but one of them is pure and one of them is impure. When is it pure? When you only ate things that Hashem allowed you to eat. When you eat things that Hashem did not allow you to eat, like non-kosher meat, you go and eat in restaurants that are not kosher, the blood in your body is impure. And that's the impure blood that keeps the soul in the brain, in the body. And no wonder why you have such a corrupted liberal head. Why everything Hashem loves you hate, and everything he hates you love. No wonder. In an argument, you can see right away who eats kosher and who doesn't. And I told you that many times in the past, I'm a witness in 30 years that I do Kiruv. We have an unbelievable phenomena in the seminars. We have people that come, the seminars usually it's 2.5 days. So let's say it started Thursday around noon. People come and they're very anti. There's a woman, she's progressing in spirituality, and she have a husband, very angry, sour face. You can see he's very anti, he's allergic to religion. He cannot even be around religious people. You can see from his body language how he suffer From the minute he arrived to the hotel and he see all the speakers and the helpers, he doesn't like to be around religious. He's from Tel Aviv, he's from the kibbutz, you know, he's from Manhattan. What am I doing with all these religious Jews here? But the wife forced him to come. So he's sitting in the lobby with the kid, he doesn't go into the lecture, he doesn't care, he didn't come to listen to lectures. He's there because the wife dragged him there. I've seen it hundreds of times. So the first day, he has such a nasty attitude. The next day, the attitude is easing up a little bit. It's not so angry and not so anti. By the third day, he's dancing with the rabbis and put tzitzit on him. You may say, wow, he came to the lecture, he heard such wonderful speeches. It affected him. After all, he has a heart of a Jew, no? I wish that was the case. He didn't go in 5 minutes. How all of a sudden he became so friendly and he's hugging the religious people and he's willing to put tzitzit and dance. Ashrenu, he sings. How this kibbutznik and this guy from Tel Aviv became like this? Only one answer. The blood in his system when he arrived to the hotel was contaminated, impure, was all made by non-kosher food. That's all he had all his life. 2.5 days that he's in the hotel, he ate like 7 or 8 or 9 meals by now, his entire blood in the body converted from not kosher to kosher blood. That's now reviving the spirituality of his soul that was dead for 30, 40, 50 years. The soul was dead inside his head. Could not hear, he was so allergic to holiness. Cannot enter a synagogue. If one time he had to come to a brit or bar mitzvah, he refused to put a yarmulke on. They hand him a yarmulke, get out of here. I'm not putting it on. If we go to the mosque, immediately he will take off his shoes. Why? It's no mitzvah to go to the mosque. The Satan encouraged it. Go to the church, go to the mosque. Very good, you're a Jew, you're not supposed to go there. But when you come into the synagogue, as soon as you walk in, it's mitzvah. Ah, the resistance begins. Every time you want to do something Hashem loves, immediately the Yetzer Hara starts his work to convince you not to do it. Rabotai, in Parashat Ki Tavoh, I have to read to you some interesting things. But before you go home today, you have something to think about for the rest of your life. Not just between now and Rosh Hashanah. For the rest of your life, do not ever forget what you're about to hear in the next hour. The parasha begins with the mitzvah of Bikurim. Bikurim, in the old days, everyone was either a farmer or a shepherd. There was no diamond dealers. There were no computer engineers. There were no surgeons in hospital, or nurses, or math teachers. You didn't have all this. You have a rabbi that teach Torah. In the Torah you will learn the math, you learn everything, it's part of Gemara. And you have shepherds, people that take care of the sheep, and you have farmers, people that grow up, fruits, vegetables. That's most of the jobs. You have tailors, people that sew and knit clothes, women that fix clothes, you have things like that. Well, you know, most of the jobs, it was a very primitive world. Remember, there's no electric, no telephones, no internet, nothing. 99.9% of the professions exist today didn't exist in those days. Didn't exist. Even a doctor was giving you all kinds of spices. It's in the Gemara, it's written a few times that the rabbis perform surgeries on people. Some of the surgeries are so complicated 2,000 years ago that no doctor in the world today knows how to do it. Like for instance, David HaMelech 3,000 years ago used to remove the spleen from his soldiers. No doctors in the world today knows how to remove a spleen. No matter what medical school he went to. If they'll try it, most likely the patient will die. He removed the spleen to all his soldiers. Why? Once you do it, they run non-stop. They don't get tired. In the old days, today it's all jeeps, cars, tanks, airplanes. Okay, you don't need to remove the spleen. Soldier doesn't have to run so much. But in the old days, it was critical. You go to war for months. You're running and running in the desert, in the forest. You need to run. You have to be in good shape. There was one thing they used to do. Or they used to make cuts in the bottom of the feet to the soldier, specific cuts, and they knew how to eliminate the nerve system of the feet. Best of my knowledge, I don't think anybody knows how to do it. I mean, to shut it down completely, I'm sure they know how to do it. But to cut in space certain places, like combinations, to make certain cuts in the feet, and the soldiers do not feel any pain in the bottom of the feet. If they run on fire, if they run on rocks, if they run on the boiling sand or on thorns or anything like that, they don't feel anything. They can be bleeding, they don't feel anything. Why? We have to fight now for our life. No time to scream with the pain in the feet. They used to make liposuction. The Chachamim made an operation on the son of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Elazar. It was massive, very, very heavy. And back then he didn't have all the surgeries and the shots, but today he's doing very well by people. So there was only one operation, is to suck out the fat. So the Gemara say that they removed two big buckets of fat from the stomach of Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Two buckets of fat, which mixed with blood, obviously. And they made him lay down on marble, which today we know marble is the most sterilized material. Clean it, it stays with no germs. Other things, they're holding germs. Marble is very sterilized. And they took two buckets of fat out of his body in the month of Tammuz, it's July, August. The Gemara described the operation he had. Today when they do liposuction, many people die, believe it or not. In liposuction, people can die. It's a life risk surgery. It's not a simple surgery like some people think. They suck the fat with a little straw. No, people die, there's complications. Even they make operation to remove veins from women's feet, from women's leg. I know one woman, she almost died in the middle of a surgery. You know, sometimes the veins come out, it doesn't look so good. By a religious woman, it's not critical because her legs are covered. By a non-religious woman, it's critical. It's the end of her life. She cannot show her legs out there. She will pay any amount to get rid of these veins. And she almost died, a mother of three kids. We had to pray for her that she won't die. That was the case. Some surgeries that looks like minor surgeries can be life risk. In the time of the Gemara, they knew things that we only discovered in the last 200 years. They knew that if you drink from someone's mouth, the germ can kill you. The Gemara said, do not drink from the leftover of the cup of your friend, because it's a life risk. Just like that. And then right away you have to ask, if it's not a life risk for him, this cup, how can it be a life risk for me? Today we know the answer, that the germs can maybe not affect Reuven, but when Shimon will drink from this cup, these germs will kill him. How come he didn't kill him, but he killed him? Only Hashem knows. We have no answer to it. Logically, both of them should have died. Why one did and why didn't? Because Hashem said so. Because life and death in the end is the decision of Hashem. They also knew that metal save us from the lightning. This was only discovered by Benjamin Franklin about 200 years ago, something like that. His picture was on the old $100 bill. Benjamin Franklin was a big scientist and a politician. He found out that if you put a metal in a roof of the highest place in a town, when the lightning hit the town, the lightning will aim to the highest metal it will find. It's magnetic. And that saves a lot of people from dying. Wet people, people that walk on potholes full of water, their life is in risk. People that right now in a lake can affect them, or people that holding metal in their hands, boom, it's gonna hit them. So he didn't discover this. It was already written in the Gemara. The Gemara say, if you put metal between your sheep, your cattle, if you do it because you want to do a black magic like the Amorites used to do, it's a sin from the Torah. But if you do it to save the sheep from the lightning, it's allowed. It's clearly in the Talmud, 2,000 years ago. Nobody gives credit to the Chachamim, to Chazal, because they don't learn about them in college. If they would only know all the things that were mentioned in the Talmud, you had a whole semester to learn about the wisdom of Chazal. But they're not aware of it. So they give the credit to all kinds of scientists who get the credit, like they discover something that was written in a Jewish literature already 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. So, Rabotai, the parasha begins with mitzvat bikurim. First fruit that grows, very nice fig, pomegranate, grapes, wow. You are desiring it so much. You have people had trees, a lot of them were farmers. You come, you see the grapes becoming ripe on the tree. You say, ah, such a great grape now, let me eat them, hard like a rock. When you buy them in a supermarket, this is after 2-3 weeks that after they took it away from the tree. If you take it out of the tree, do you know how hard they are? You can break someone's head with that. Nothing is greater than hard grapes. Nothing is worse than soft grapes. I mean, I know some people like it. Most people, they check the grapes before they buy. Same thing, tomatoes. They're too soft, nobody wants it. Unless you want to make a tomato paste. But the fruits, you want them to be sweet and hard. Now you want to eat it? No. You have to take it. You have to put a special thing on it, special mark. It's called gemi. And you, when the time comes, you put it all in a basket. And you go to Jerusalem, to the temple, and you give it to the Kohanim there, the Levim. If you pour, you put it in a basket that is made from straws. You knead it yourself. You can throw it, nobody cares about it. If you're a rich person, you bring it in a gold basket or silver basket. What's the difference? When the Kohanim gets it, when the Beit HaMikdash, they get it in a gold basket, they dump it to a different basket and they give you back the basket because it has a high value. But the poor people, when they give it in a disposable basket, they just throw it away. They don't even bother to give it back. Because everyone can make as much as they want. It doesn't have a value. So that's a very big test. You are dying to eat the fruits that came out. They are so good and delicious. You have to take them all the way to Jerusalem and give it as a gift in a bikurim. When? In the holidays. Chol HaMoed Sukkot. You come and you give it to them as a gift. So that's mitzvah of bikurim. Also, you have to declare now, you have a special ceremony that you have to declare, I did as Hashem commanded me. It's a whole thing. So this mitzvah of bikurim, it has to be from the 7 superb fruits of the Holy Land. What are they? Wheat, barley, grapes, figs, pomegranate, olives, and dates. Dates. When it says honey in the Gemara, it doesn't talk about the honey of the bees. Honey that comes from the dates. The dates in the old days used to drip honey. Eretz zavat, chalav udvash. Dvash of the dates. And the Gemara learns it in the Yerushalmi Talmud. You learn it from Gzera Shavah in 2 Psukim, that the mitzvah is not just to bring fruit, peaches, melons, no. From the 7 fruits that are special, special in the Holy Land. Today you have it almost all over the world. You have grapes everywhere, dates, and many places. But in Eretz Israel, the fruits was the best in all over the world. Today, they still export a lot of fruits from Israel. Oranges, all kinds of things. Sometimes you go to Costco, you see Jaffa. But I can tell you that when I was a kid in Israel, as opposed to today, the fruits in Israel 45, 50 years ago used to be maybe 50 times better than today. Nothing to compare. Today, there's not that much of a difference between the fruits in Israel to the fruits of America or the fruits of Mexico. Hard to tell the difference. Grape, grape, peach, peach, almost the same. But I remember when I came to America in 1989, I used to go buy fruits here and I said to myself, ugh, who can eat such fruits? Because the fruits in Israel were so much better. It's like eating sand. Today you can hardly tell the difference. I don't see that much of a difference. Why? Because the Torah says that the quality of the fruits and the cleanness of the fruit, if they'll be clean from bugs and worms and all of that, depends on the sins of the people of the land. When the people commit a lot of sins, what happens? The quality of the fruits from the land becomes less and less. And there are more worms. Today, almost everything you buy, you have to clean from worms. You buy cherries, inside the cherries you have worms. Even inside onions, inside large peppers, you have inside garlic. Who would believe inside the garlic you're gonna have tiny worms? You have worms in the fish, you have worms in the meat, you have worms almost everywhere. In the water that you drink, if you take a magnifying glass and you put it in a glass barrel, in the sun, and you take a magnifying glass, you're gonna see thousands of microscopic worms floating inside the water. Today, Baruch Hashem, we have filters and all kinds of things to get rid of it. But you can see it. How can we drink water? Based on that, if you go to a place, drink water, it may have hundreds of worms in it. The answer is, worms that you cannot see with the eye are not forbidden in the Torah. The Torah was not given to angels. Angels can see microscopic things. We cannot see. Today we have magnifying glass, we have telescope, microscopes, all these things. But back in time, how are you going to know? You look at the lettuce, you clean it, you look at the sun, whatever you can see. No, you don't see it, fine, you can eat it. If they'll bring a microscope and they find microscopic things moving, you didn't break the laws of the Torah. But there's still a question if it contaminates the soul or not. After all, you eat worms. Or you eat a microscopic mosquito. Call it bar hashim. They're smaller than a dot. It's hard to see them sometimes. You check. If I want to eat figs, sometimes they bring figs to Costco. You open it, there's no way to see if there are worms there or not. The worms looks exactly like the inside of the figs. The only way is to take a big magnifying glass and you make it 10 times bigger and then you check for about a minute carefully if there is a worm or not. If there is a worm, you're gonna see a movement. Sometimes it's a dead worm. Then you won't see a movement. That's why you have to be very careful. Better not to eat it. This is fruits and vegetables. Sometimes it's better to avoid, like strawberry. There's no way to eat strawberries unless you shave it from the outside, all the dots. You gotta shave the entire outside. Then you can eat the inside. Why? There's so many inside the holes. You cannot see them. It's problematic. Corn. If you eat corn, you have to be careful that it's fresh. Sometimes they sell it, it's in the fridge for 2 weeks in the store. Even in Costco, I see a lot of white dots on it. Especially if there's humidity inside the bag. The humidity increases the bacteria, and then you begin to see eggs of worms, tiny little things. You see, it smells even. So you have to be careful, Rabotai. There's books about how to clean the vegetables and the fruits. We didn't have this problem 2,000 years ago. This is a curse in the Torah, that the fruits and the vegetables will be contaminated by worms and all kinds of insects that will eat them and make holes in them. It's a curse in the Torah. And it comes because of the sins of the people. It's not nature. It's because today there are so many sins, it affects the world. Everything. The Ramchal speaks about it. When a person commits a sin, it affects everything around him in the room. Everything. So for instance, if you want to buy a used furniture from a Chinese man, Recommended or not?
Not.
Very not recommended. Why? Why? It's a high possibility that he put his Buddha on it. An idol, and worship his idol on that table or around the table. The last thing you want is an item that was a base of an idol inside your living room. You don't want it. So you gotta be very careful. If you buy it from countries in the East that they are idol worshippers, it's very bad. What happened if you buy this used table from an Arab? Less of a problem. Why? He doesn't bow down to an idol, this Arab. He didn't put an idol on the table and bow down. Arabs believe in one God. You have to see there's so many things that people are not aware of. So, Rabotai, a person says, you know, Jacob went to Egypt, we came out of Egypt, I'm bringing the first fruits of the land. All of these things he says, and he makes a declaration. I did as you commanded me, Hashem. Why there is such a mitzvah? To break your ego, to break your pride. Even a king has to bring. King comes with a basket to serve it to the Kohen, standing on line, to bring the fruits of his fields. You waited a year for the fruits to be ripe. Now you have to overcome your desire and bring it as a gift. Even if you're a billionaire, even if you own the whole town, even if you own all the fields, you stand on line like everyone and you come with a basket and serve it to a Kohen that is 14 years old. Little kid. Shalom, Yosef Kohen. Wow. Imagine, try to imagine such a scenario. You have, what's his name? This is the mayor of New York, Bloomberg. He's a Jew. They say it's $40 billion. He comes now to Beit HaMikdash with the baskets of fruits, and he gives it to a Kohen, 14 years old, that doesn't have $2 to his name. That's humiliating. He feels, I'm the owner of New York, I own buildings, I own companies, and this kid, what is he? Just started to walk a few years ago, and I have to wait online to give him fruits, the first fruits from my trees? That's to break your ego. The Torah say, the king has to travel around with Sefer Torah always with him. Why? That he has to learn all the time. Why? That his heart should never be higher than the rest of the nation. Should be humble, like he's just an ordinary resident of this country. King! King! Nominated by Hashem. Hashem sent the prophet to say he is the new king, like King David. He will be the king that I want. And he has to walk with Sefer Torah and learn, because learning Torah makes you humble. When you humble, you do not want to act arrogant. Why? Who am I? You know, who am I? What am I? So, Rabotai, the parasha continue. V'haya ki tavo el haaretz. Right? V'aya, every time the Torah uses the word V'aya, that's a language of happiness. The Torah is teaching us that to make Aliyah and enter the Holy Land should be the happiest day of your life. A person that finally had the zchut, the merit, to move from what country he lives in, to move his resident to the Holy Land. That being said, no one is allowed to move to Israel today without sitting for hours with his personal rabbi that knows him and his entire family very well, knows his business, knows his marriage, knows where his children learn, knows parnasa-wise, health-wise, location-wise. And after hundreds of questions back and forth, should be an FBI investigation, the rabbi has to reach a verdict if they should move to Israel or not. There are hundreds of factors. For now, just now, one of the factors is if you're allowed to move to a place of life risk. Right now, unfortunately, every day you live in Israel, your life is in a higher risk than America. Yeah, there are plenty of anti-Semites here, and there's always a risk here as well, and in Europe even more. But is the risk is the same like living in Haifa right now, that getting missiles falling around your house? The answer is no. Are you allowed to risk your life? The answer is no. If you move to a place of a life risk that your life can stop right there or your children can die, and you didn't die, Hashem cleans your file from your merits. Because he has to perform miracles to save you from death. A missile was supposed to fall where you live, where you moved to. But Hashem had to stop it because he doesn't want you dead. So because of that, he takes away some of your credits. Menakim lo miskuyotav. This is let's hope that that's a temporary situation right now. Hopefully when we finish with these evil Nazis, maybe we'll have a peace of mind for a year or two or five, that we will be able to live relatively safely in Israel after the war. Now we talk about Israel when there's no war. No war. You can live in some of the religious neighborhoods. Usually it's peaceful over there. Now you want to move. There are many, many things to consider. First, what's your job right now in your income? What will be your job there in your income? Second, what kind of wife you have? Is she a spoiled prima donna? That she's gonna have a small sink and she's gonna drop dead? Or she's the easygoing woman that you put her anywhere and she manages? She can have a mental breakdown. She has a $1 million kitchen in Great Neck, right? Right now, you wanna move her to a small house in Israel. She's gonna see the kitchen size of her little closet. And she's gonna start crying all day with the Tehillim. Hashem, why did I need this for? She cannot function anymore. Why? Some people are so materialistic in their nature that if they don't have a 5-carat diamond, they cannot survive a day. Give her any diamond, dirty, synthetic, as long as it's big. Why? How will I show up to all my friends with a 2-carat? That's her level. You want to move her to Ashdod? To Be'er Sheva? To one of the little tiny apartments in Shkunat HaBukharin when there's no elevator. If you're a multi-millionaire and can buy a fancy, beautiful home in Beit Vagan, I don't know, $10 million home in Rehavia, top. So, you know, materialistic, there's no problem. She will have it here, she'll have it there. You import nice cars, good things, you bring a whole boat, you have everything you had in America, you have over there. But there's other things. The kids are in good yeshivot, they're doing well, yeah. They learn in English, they don't know a word in Hebrew. You're gonna put them now in yeshiva, it's all in Hebrew. They'll have a mental breakdown. They'll go off the derech. Most yeshiva won't accept them, so I'm sorry. What am I gonna do with this American kid? So you have to put them in American yeshivas. American yeshivas, compared to Israeli yeshivas, is night and day and night. It's nothing to compare. Other thing to consider is the relatively gentle lifestyle of the American kids as opposed to the aggressive lifestyle of the Israeli kids. They call it chutzpah Israelit. The Israeli kids are very tough. They grew up in a tough world, in a tough environment, lots of poverty, lots of anger, huge heat all the time, lots of terror attacks, a lot of stress. It's not the same of someone who grew up in Monsi in a beautiful things, hearing the birds at 3 a.m. already singing by his window. It's a little bit different. You take a very gentle kid, you know, that he has a very soft heart, and you put him over there, you may destroy him. You can destroy the kids. There's so many things to consider. I always say, if you have nothing here, you have zero parnasa here, no shiduch here, no kids over here, no nothing over here, nothing. You have nothing over here. If that's the case, oh, so if I don't have anything here and I don't have anything there, at least I'm on the Holy Land. Then that's a great upgrade. But if you have good job and good marriage and good home and good community and you love your synagogue and you have good rabbi and you have great chevruta and your kids are doing well and the kids are learning well and they're all very religious and they are very nice with their mentality and traits, and now you want to jeopardize all of that and go on an adventure just to be in a Holy Land, before you become a huge criminal and you destroy the life of your family, you must sit with a very big rabbi. What if the rabbi gave you the wrong advice? Rabbis are not God. They can also sometimes make mistakes. Even though when a rabbi is holy and is a Talmid Chacham, Hashem saves him from mistakes for the sake of the public, because if his reputation will get ruined, then there will be no rabbis that anyone will ask questions to, and that's against God's will. He has to protect his rabbis. Why? Because the rabbis represent him. You want your representative to have a solid, strong position, that he won't look like a clown in the eyes of the public. That's why Hashem have a strong incentive to save the rabbis from making mistakes. But at the same time, Hashem also wants to show people that there is a difference between a holy rabbi to God. With all due respect to him, and there is a huge respect, he's still not God. Therefore, he may commit some mistakes here and there. Why? To show you that it's human, to show him that he's human. To keep his humility, to keep him humble. If he gave you the wrong advice, and you acted on his advice, and it caused you some damage, you have to believe fully that there was the will of Hashem. If he told you, yeah, buy the business, Bezrat Hashem, you'll do well, and you lost all your money in that business, you have to believe that Hashem put words in his mouth for you to lose all your money because one or two of your kids were supposed to die. And Hashem had mercy on you and replaced this tragedy with $1 million damage. What's better, to lose two kids or to lose $1 million that you saved? The answer is clear. And at the same time, you know one thing, you have an insurance protection. When you come in front of Hashem, there is no claim against you. Why? Because you acted with the advice of Da'at Torah, a reliable, knowledgeable, with good reputation, holy rabbi. Not just one of the clowns that I have in my blacklist. With them, the last thing you want is to stand next to them and look at their lousy face. We're talking serious Talmidei Chachamim. You know, every community, Baruch Hashem, they have the rabbis. In Brooklyn, the Syrian community, a few good rabbis, they can ask them. They know how to give advice. They have many years, decades of experience. They know the community. They know what they're good with, what they're not so good with. They know what to recommend. In the Persian community, the Ashkenazi community, the Baruch Hashem, lo alman Israel. There are a few that you can count on. And you have to make sure you don't do and then ask. Many people ask me after the fact, Rabbi, don't ask, I made Aliyah now, nothing works here, none of my kids in the yeshiva, I don't know what to do, I thought I'm going to have this job, now I don't have a job, I'm eating all my savings, what's going to be, in 2 weeks I'm going to be on the street. Now he remembers to call the rabbi and ask. What is the rabbi going to do? Send him $2 million to every person who called with the trouble? The idea is, Rabotai, when you act with the Da'at Torah, at least Hashem will not hold you guilty of the damages that may occur later on. Why? What do you want? I asked the big Chacham. He told me to do it. Okay. Case is dismissed. You acted on your own. Everything that may happen, it's on you. You may get lucky. For some people, it was finding a treasure. For some people, it was finding a poison. Depends who the person is. But in the time of the Torah, that's when they are entering Israel for the first time. They're getting rid of 7 nations of idol worshippers. And they establish themselves for the first time in Holy Land. That's happiness for everybody. Why? Because it's a direct command from Hashem to every one of the Jewish nation. What we don't have today. Today, every one of us can say for sure that Hashem wants him to move there. There's no guarantee. Maybe yes, maybe not. But back then, when Hashem said, "V'aya ki tavo el haaretz," you're going to enter to the land. That's before we enter the land. This is in the desert. This is the last month of the life of Moshe Rabbeinu. Shortly after, they're going to enter Israel with Joshua. Moshe is going to pass in a few days. That's a few days before his death. Joshua is going to enter them to the Holy Land. And it will take 7 years war to fight those seven evil nations, and 7 more years to share the land to the tribes. 14 years of preparation. And that's when the happiness will begin. And now the Torah is speaking about, you have your yards, you have your vineyards, you have wheat, you have barley, you have pomegranates, it's all over Israel. Olive trees everywhere. Now when you have the first fruits, don't be greedy. Control your desire, control your stinginess. Run, make a basket, and run to the Kohen and give it to him in Beit HaMikdash in Yom Tov, meaning in Chol HaMoed. How much you have to bring if you have 10 big vineyards? Vineyards you have, 10 thousands of trees of grapes, or thousands of trees of olives. Do you know how much an olive tree costs? I went to our farm where the Arabs grew them, next to Jerusalem. I asked him, how much is an olive tree? Told me, depend on the size. Small one like this, 1 foot tall, but you need years until it will grow, 3,000 shekel. Almost $1,000 at that time. Large one, that you need 2-3 people to carry it, 12,000 shekel, almost $4,000. It sounds very expensive. Do you know how expensive olives are? You come to the olive tree and you shake it. You put the big blankets under. Thousands of olives are falling. You put them with some vinegar, some salt, some lemon, you know, in a big jar. A little container like this, $7, $8. You have 1,000 containers. Thousands of containers in one season. Each one you sell for a few dollars wholesale. Or, you know, it's a very big profit. The Arabs have thousands of olive trees in Israel. See, all the way to the Galilee, you see olive trees everywhere. They're also in territories that don't belong to anyone. Good luck taking it out and moving it into your house. It's a big job, nobody touch it. But I know someone who goes to Amuka, to the graves of the Tanaim in the Galil. He has a few trees in the mountains there that don't belong to anyone. He goes and bangs the trees, he collects a lot of olives, and he makes the best olive on earth. The best one, crunchy like this, you never see anywhere something like this. Directly from the tree. So, you know, this is what everyone did. It was all farms. People have chickens, they have sheep, they have cows, they have trees. That was the job that everyone had. What do? You have to bring. How much? 1 out of 60 from what you have. From the Torah, any basket you make, it's enough. Doesn't matter how many fields you have. You have 1 field or 100 fields. You make 1 nice basket, you bring it to the Beit HaMikdash, finished. You're dismissed. But the Chachamim made a minimum requirement. What is it? 1 out of 60. 1.6%. That could be a lot. If you're a rich man, 1.6, you know. There are people who invest millions of dollars on a stock. For ordinary people, if the stock is $45.20, if it went down from $45.20 to $45.30, an average person, it went up $20, $50 up or down. No big deal. 10 cents doesn't make a difference. Even if it goes up a dollar, it could be $1,000, $2,000, depending on how many stocks you own. Average person. But there are big sharks. They can have a million of these stocks. Million of these stocks. The stock moved 10 cents. 10 cents doesn't move in the graph, nothing. 10 cents is $100,000. His stocks can go up and down by hundreds of thousands of dollars from 9:30 in the morning until 4 p.m. He can be up 200,000, he can be down 400,000. To the ordinary person, it's 50 up, 20 down, 30 up. It's all depend on how much you have. Same thing over here. 1.5% from an ordinary person, no big deal. It doesn't affect business, but someone that has a lot, same thing the Maaser. Who usually give Maaser? The rich people or the poor? The poor. I'm witnessing it. The poor are makpid on maaser. Why? He makes $2,000 a month. It's not enough barely to survive here bichlal. He makes sure to struggle to give the 200. Someone who makes not 2,000, 200,000 every month. That's a very successful business. He has to give 20,000 every month. When he writes the check, his hands are shaking. Wow, $20,000 is a car. Every month I'm losing a car. The poor man, $200. Why am I, what am I losing? $200. That's Oef kesef, lo yisba kesef, the Gemara says. Someone that loves money, is in love with money. Everyone loves money to some extent. If you don't love money, you're not normal. Money can be replaced to millions of valuable things. Books, Gemara, Talit, Tefillin, good mezuzah, a car to go places, to go to shul, to go to yeshiva. Money, it's not the green or the coins that you have. Money is all the things you need in life to serve Hashem faithfully. So you have to have appreciation for money. That's not what we're talking about. We are talking about someone who has plenty, more than enough for all his needs and all his children needs and his grandchildren needs. And what does he do? Robbing people day and night in his businesses. Taking the last drop of blood out of their body. Why? His greed is so strong, he's never satisfied with what he gets. Never. אוהב כסף, חזל זה, לא יסבא כסף. יש לו מנה, רוצה 200. He has 100, immediately he aims for 200. יש לו 200, he aims for 400. He has 400, immediately he aims to 800. Meaning, the more he has, the more he's short of. He has 1 million, now he's aiming to 2. That's one, I need at least to make it 2. So the more he has, the more he feels that he's short of. Someone who hardly have anything. I told you the story about this guy that gave me few cents donation. Remember, what was it? 59 cents? See, 79 cents, I don't even remember. It was less than a dollar donation with Venmo. I say to myself, wow, poor guy. Because he wrote in a donation, this is the last money I have to my name. You remember that story or no? This was like 3 months ago, something like that. You can go in the lectures and hear, I told the story. He wrote over there, this is the last money I have to my name. It was less than a dollar. I sent it to about 8 or 9 people. Some of them are very wealthy people. They're not so generous. Some of them saw it, said, whoa, oh wow, you know, oh wow. Poor guy, I feel bad for him. You know, comments like this. But 2 people say, I felt so guilty looking at myself in the mirror. He has nothing. The last few pennies he had, he gave. So the thanks to him, 2 people gave a nice donation. So I wrote to him, you don't even know with the few cents that you send what you actually affected other people to give out of guilt. Why? Because, wow, this guy has millions, barely gives anything. This guy gave the last few cents to his name. It's not that easy, Rabotai. So, let's move on. We cover Bikurim. Has to be remembered, the first fruits that come. The next thing in a parasha, Vanitzak, when you come and make the declaration, you say, Vayareu otanu amitzrim. These things that we say in the Haggadah of Pesach. Many of the things that we say in the Haggadah come from this confession. מה זה ויראו אותנו המצרים? What does it mean? It should have been ויראו לנו המצרים. Not אותנו. לנו, to us. Not us, to us. They gave bad problems to us. ויראו אותנו המצרים, they made us evil. That's what it means. How did they make you evil? I'll tell you how. In the Holocaust, a Nazi that wanted to abuse 2 Jews that they know they didn't eat from yesterday all day, 24 hours, He would put one slice of bread in like this on the table and say to them, fight for it. Whoever will kill the other will get the bread. To turn you into a monster. Some people say, no, we'll die, but we won't fight. We won't kill each other for the bread. You want to give, fine. You don't want to give, we'll die. But some people were monsters. Right away, they started to kill the other. Take the bread, give me alone. No. Turn them into monsters. People were actually killing each other for one slice of bread. Why? That's how they turn you into a monster. You want to survive? Whoever kills each other comes out. The one who lost will kill him. That's how they used to turn you into monsters. And they enjoy the show. So, vayareu otanu ha-mitzrim. In slavery, they were torturing us so much, they turned us into wounded animals. When a person becomes a wounded animal, don't expect him to have manners. וניצק אל השם אלוקי אבותינו וישמע השם את קולנו. We scream to Hashem and Hashem heard our voice. וחפץ חיים say, it doesn't say here, and Hashem listened to our prayers. It says Hashem heard our voice. From here we learn that when you speak to Hashem, you have to scream from the bottom of your heart. If you're in a synagogue and everyone is quiet, don't start screaming like a mishugine, like a crazy wacko. Ah! Hey, shh! I'm trying to focus here. But if everybody screams, scream! If you're alone, close the door and scream and cry. Shake the world. Why is it important if you scream loud or not so loud? Why it's important? You try it. When you scream loud, it brings you into tears. When you don't scream so loud, it's hard to cry. Scream like you rip your heart apart. Immediately the crying comes right with this. That's the way Hashem made us. So they scream to Hashem. And Hashem accepted their prayers because they were screamed from a lot of pain. It's written in Midrash Rabbah. יש תפילה שנענית ל-40 יום. Now we're going to learn the secret of the prayers. Some of our prayers will be accepted in 40 days. Hashem is waiting 40 days and then he accepts the prayer. Some prayers are accepted after 20 days. Some prayers are accepted after 3 days. Some prayers are accepted after 1 day. And some prayers, before you finish your request, you already got it. Before you finish your request, you already got it. As it's written, Terem ikrau v'ani e'ene. Terem ikrau v'ani e'ene. It happens a lot. A lot. How does Hashem decide how long it will take for your prayers to be accepted? There are many, many reasons for it. One depends how holy you are. If you're a very holy man, your prayers are more powerful and accepted faster because there's no sins for that Satan can use to prevent from Hashem to accept your prayers. There's no kitrug. Second, depend on how much you're watching your eyes. If you look all days of the ladies, you don't have holiness in your neshama. The Satan is using it against you. If you speak a lot of gossip, lashon hara, the Satan is using it against you. A filthy mouth like this that destroyed the life of people with his gossip will request something for himself and you run to perform for him? Where is the justice? This righteous person, you made him wait 20 days or 40. This guy with his filthy mouth, you're helping him to get it right away? Within an hour he got what he requested? It's not fair. But if you don't speak Lashon Hara, the Satan doesn't have a case. If you give a lot of charity, you give a lot of tzedakah, then it eliminates the ability of the Satan to make cases against you, because you are loved specially by Hashem. And the Satan is thinking a million times before he gets Hashem angry by coming to speak negative against you, because you're helping so many miserable people every day with your generous heart. When someone like that, it's very hard to be mekatreg on him. If you learn a lot of Torah, you can go and make tons of money, but instead you sit and learn Torah all day in yeshiva and live simple life with a little budget. When the Satan wants to come and say that Hashem should not listen to your prayers, he is risking himself. Someone that sits 14, 15 hours a day and give his life for my Torah, which makes me the happiest, you dare to bring me negative things against him? So you obviously understand that when you go to a holy, big chacham, big rabbi, that his life is all day, always in the Torah, and he will pray for you, your chances are now just got 1,000% greater that the prayers will be accepted. And there is also one more thing, how much merit that person has. Merit. What does it mean, merit? How many good things happened in the world thanks to you? Thanks to your mouth, thanks to your actions, thanks to your donations, thanks to all the things you've done in your life. Thanks to how many people you made them religious and now they make Hashem happy. So when someone made billions and trillions of good deeds for Hashem, he has a special VIP status. And it's written as a clear verse, Motzi yakar mipi zolel. That this person, if he says something, Hashem must take it to consideration. Must take it to consideration. Why? Because there's no one that have done so much for Hashem like that person. That's why his blessings, his prayers, when he prays for someone or anything like that, helps the person the most you can imagine. The most. Why? Because the more happy you make Hashem with your life, the more he's willing to accept your prayers. So obviously, if you mechalel Shabbat, if you are a sote, a mentally sick person that lives with your own kind, and you are all day watching dirty things, and you are not giving any charity, and you eat everything you see, and you live with no holiness, no tarat mishpacha, no mikveh, no nothing. The way you dress, your body is full of tattoos. It's so dirty that as soon as you open your mouth, the Satan have thousands of kitrugim against you. Look at him, look how he looks. How does he dare to even come and ask you? That's why, Rabotai, there are things in life that once you do it, there's no way to go back. Fill up your body with tattoos. Good luck erasing it now. Some people make surgeries. Men become women, women becomes men. One day they want to repent, it's too late for them. Became a woman now. How is he going to come to the shul? Wants to come to pray on Yom Kippur. Where is he going to sit? By the men, by the women? There's a lot of problems here. Me'uvat lo yuchal litkon. Some things you did in your life, there's no way to fix. So, okay. Almost all of us did things like this in our past, in our young days. Who didn't write in the internet bad comments about individuals that were on the news? It travels to thousands of ears and eyes. There's no way to save it now. The rumors continue to travel. The people that you wrote about continue to suffer 10 years later. It's still online. Yes, it stays. What you put, that's it. Google finds it. How are you going to fix it? Not everything can be fixed. So what are we going to do? Only one thing. Cry non-stop to Hashem to forgive us. We were stupid. We were not aware of what we were doing. Please have mercy on us. Please, please, please. And Hashem may have mercy on you based on what you became from now on. You used to be terrible, but now Hashem sees what a drastic change, 180 degrees. No more Lashon Hara, no more internet, no more provocative clothes in the street. No more of all these horrible things you used to do. 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. At one point, even the Satan has no claim against you. Then the next thing it's written, וסמכת בכל הטוב אשר נתן לך השם אלוקיך. You have to be happy with all the good that Hashem gave you. Rashi writes here, the Chachamim in Masechet Bikurim, they say, אין קוראים מקרא ביקורים, you don't read the announcement when you bring the baskets with the fruit, you read it only in a time of happiness. When is a time of happiness? From Shavuot, from the holiday of Shavuot, until the holiday of Sukkot. After Sukkot, right? If a person wants to bring the basket after Sukkot, let's say he was sick in Sukkot, he couldn't come. He wants to come after Sukkot, between Sukkot and Chanukah. He can bring the basket, but he cannot make the announcement. The announcement is only when you're happy. Why are you only happy between Shavuot and Sukkot? Who knows?
Because the king is in the field.
Very good. Because all your annual income comes to you from the field. Everything you planted, you cut between Shavuot and Sukkot. Remember, it was a different world than today. Today people have income all year round, every day, every other day. It's all seasons. It's similar to, let's say a person has a business that works only in the summertime in New York. 4 months summer. 8 months, cold. Cannot go to the water, sit by the water, it's freezing. 4 months, let's say you have a business that rent boats, rent all kinds of umbrellas, you know, place where people go by the pool. It's only 4 months. Those 4 months is enough for you for the whole year. Let's say you make matzahs for Pesach. You start 2-3 months before Pesach. You make hundreds of tons of matzahs. A week or two before Pesach, you get rid of everything. Pesach, you are loaded. But it's enough now until a month before the next Pesach. You gotta live all year round. Let's say you are the owner of a camp. 2 months in the summer, you have a camp. And it's enough for all year round to support your family. So those 2 months of the summer when thousands of dollars goes into your account every day, every day, every day from the payments of the people of the camp, those were the happiest time of your year. This is the words of the Gemara. From here we learn that if someone tells you money does not make me happy, is a liar. It's true that every rule have an exception to the rule. Obviously, there are some people that really, really completely not materialistic, that they can live with one slice of bread a day and water and they're good. And they enough for them, one or two suits for years. They don't care. They're not in the show-off business. They don't care about watches, about nothing. They don't want a car. They want to walk from the house to the yeshiva, learn all day, come home, eat something simple, soup, a little bread. There are people like this. They are not feeling anything bad that I don't have a lot of money and I cannot afford fancy stuff. They don't even know what fancy stuff is. For them, it's all the same. But regular people, people that walk around, see things, they want to have things. And when they get monies that allow them to buy certain things, again, it could be holy things, tefillin, mezuzot. You need money to buy good product. So it makes the person happy. Makes the person happy. I've seen few times when we were collecting money for poor, holy people, When we gave them the money, I saw in their body language how they became so happy. I'm not gonna get up and dance now, but they were so appreciative. See, a lot of stress came out. Why? It's natural. Anyone who deny it, no, good luck to him with his tricks. So there are some exceptions to the rules, yes, but the general rule is people are happy when they have income. When they don't have to stress, then they have enough to pay the bills. If they are very poor, there is no bigger curse in life than poverty, Chazal say. Gzerat aniyut. And I'm not talking about someone who can only afford a small apartment. That's not poor. In relation to someone that has a $20 million mansion, is poor, yes. But in 70% of the people in the world don't even have that apartment in New York. He lives in a project in New York. In Africa, they live any better? In most of the Muslim countries, they have any better apartments? In some places, they don't even have a bathroom. They don't even have a sink. They have to go to the lake to wash their laundry. In most of the world, some places, they don't have roads. You have to go with a broken bike in the mud every day. I remember when I came to America in 1989, didn't have anything. Just came after the army. I lived by someone's in Great Neck. I found a job in a bagel store in Little Neck Parkway. There used to be a Scoby diner there, an OTB, where all the gamblers come and scream, "Go, Johnny, go!" Well, the horses run, you know, and scream. There was a bagel store, still there, by the way, this bagel store there. Since still there. So, now where I lived was in Great Neck, and the bagel store is in Little Neck. That was about 2-3 miles driving from Lake Success to Northern Boulevard. And one Ashkenazi American woman, a friend of the wife of my father's friend where I lived for the first 2 months, she came. Look how Hashem runs the world. She looks at me, "Who are you?" "I'm the guest, I came." "What are you doing here?" "I started to work in a bagel store." "Where?" "Over there." "Oh yeah, by the diner." "Yes, how do you like it?" "So, well, it's not an easy job. I gotta be there at 6 a.m. in the morning." "How do you go there at 6 a.m.? Because there's no transportation there. It's a big problem. I have a very big problem." She said to me, "You know what? I can give you a bike. I have a bike in my garage, bicycle. Do you want it?" I say, "Yes." You know how happy I was for this bike? How much a bike was that those days? Not even $100, 1989. But it was those sport bikes, you know, that you bend out. It has very thin wheels. I used to go from Great Neck to there with a bike. But guess what? The snow started, November. Snow, 1 foot of snow, and I'm going with the bike in the snow and sliding 100 feet with the bike, like ski. If you know, there is a huge down the hill going from Great Neck to that corner over there. And I say to myself, "Wow, at least I have a bike. Scarves, hats, 20 below zero. But that's better than walking. Walk, it's an hour." In the end, Rabotai, if you compare yourself to the majority of the world, your situation is better than almost all of them. The problem is, you live in New York, you see so many billionaires out there. You see in fancy places of Miami, New York, Beverly Hills. Okay, that's a very small percentage of the people in the world. Go to Saudi Arabia, see 50 million people, how they live. Go to India. People live on a sidewalk with 10 kids, with rats like this. Mattresses, they used to be white, now they more black than this microphone stand. People that were there told me what's going on over there. They live on the sidewalk, miles. They have no house. They sleep with their children on the sidewalk. It rains on them, the rats coming and bite them. In the day, in the morning, they wake up, they have mark bites of this big rat size of a watermelon. You complain about your little tiny apartment in a project here in Queens Boulevard. This Indian will kill for that apartment. Dishwasher? 80% of the people in the world don't even know what it is. Go to China, see how billion Chinese live in an igloo made from straws. One typhoon, all their stuff fly 100 yards in the air. Floods everywhere. Rabotai, it's a very good advice to look at people that have less than you. It will give you a peace of mind and comfort. If you look at people that have a lot more than you, you'll never be full and satisfied. This is the nature of the people. Most people have jealousy. Look at the women, how they compare jewelry. Wow, we got it. Such a lucky girl, can I try her on? That's why the Gemara says, shouldn't go with jewelry on Shabbat in Reshut HaRabim. Why? It's guaranteed she'll take it off. Why? To show it to her friends, to take her eye out. Why? That's the way people are. All these brand names that people buy, Gucci, Schmucci, Armani, thousands of dollars for tiny press. Why would somebody normal spend $5,000 on a little wallet? Why? There's only one reason for that G. That's the symbol G. Gucci, what? They have a G on it. People recognize the name. So they make a lot of fake ones. Fake ones. Looks exactly the same. Oh, but it's fake. I'm not gonna wear fake. Listen, you fool. The fake one was made in the same exact factory that the real one was made. One to one. There's only one thing. They didn't sell it to Gucci. They went behind their back and sold it in the black market for 80% less or 95% less. What do you think they do, these Chinese people in China or in India? You give them an order of 100,000 bags. They make 120. After they give you what you want, the 20 they sell in the black market. What do you think is happening? What all these fake things that you have? Same thing, one person who used to make suits for Armani, Ridelli, not Armani. Ridelli was very good brand, Italian. He say they order 2,000 suits, I make 2,500. Once they buy their 2,000, I sell the other suits without the name Ridelli. Meaning it's the same suit. The Ridelli back then, 20 years ago, was $2,000 a suit. A regular suit was $150. Same one, but it doesn't have the tag. There are enough fools here that would pay $2,000 for this just because of that tag. But you know what? Someone even told me that some people sell tags only. Fake tags. Why? People are losers. Losers. Nothing on their own to offer. So they have tags to show off their watch, to show off their car. Hashem cannot stand it. So you have to be down to earth and you'll be happy with all the good that Hashem gave you. There's only one problem. If you are learning Torah and you learn what Hashem called good and what He calls bad, now you can fulfill this obligation. If you don't learn Torah, you are an Am Haaretz fool. Your mind is empty. You have zero holiness, zero knowledge, and everything you know comes from the news or from the public school. So your mind is corrupted with tons of nonsense. So people brainwash you that this is good and this is good, and Hashem says it's disgusting. It's terrible. I'll give you an example. Hashem say nails for women, it's disgusting, it's ugly, and it's despicable. How do we learn it? I taught you not last week here, when we spoke about Eshet Yifat Tohar. Shave her head off, bald woman, it's ugly, Hashem said. Woman needs hair. Women have to have beauty. That's a part of their purpose in the world. They have to be pretty for their men. That's what the Torah says. Lo nitnu nashim ela leofi. It's written in the Gemara. So a woman must be pretty to her men. If that's his taste, she has to be pretty to his taste. To his taste, not to somebody else. He likes her, that's it. The rest of the world thinks she's ugly. Doesn't make any difference. For him, he's happy. Everybody must tell him she's pretty. Even if it's not your taste. How is my new fiance? Wow, Baruch Hashem, Ishtabach Shemo. You got very lucky. 5 minutes ago, you told your brother, wow, what an ugly girl he got engaged to. Now he comes to us, what are you going to tell him? Oh, well, your girl is very ugly, man. Hey, bro. You know, the American kids. Hey, bro. Come on, you could have done better. Well, you already destroyed Shalom Bayit. It's a crime to say such thing. Ah, but you're not allowed to lie, the Gemara say. Hashem cannot stand liars. The Torah say lies for the sake of peace is not only allowed, it's an obligation, especially to make peace between the husband and wife. If the wife spoke to the rabbi about her cheap husband, and the husband is looking like this, who knows what she's saying about me now? Who knows? Soon as she gets up, he runs. Hi, Rabbi, how are you? Let's drink L'chaim. Tell me, by the way, I see my wife is crying to you too much recently. Everything okay? Baruch Hashem. What did she have to say? She complains about me? No. She said, you're the greatest guy. You're such a good father. You're such a tzaddik. How you go to shul, how you wake up by yourself every morning. How no matter what she cooks, you always say thank you and you're happy. The rabbi make up a whole speech. Every word is a lie. The more he lies, the more reward he's gonna get. Why? He make the husband live in peace with them. How did we learn it? From Avraham Avinu. Sarah say, how can I give birth? My husband is an old man. You worry about your husband? You are old, you are 90. Old, it's only affecting the women when it comes to birth, not the men. A man can be 70, can still have kids. A woman past a certain age cannot have kids anymore. So Sarah should have said, how can I give birth? I'm an old woman. My time is finished. Nobody froze egg for me 3,000 years ago. So Sarah said, but my husband is an old man. And when Hashem came to Abraham, he didn't say, she say you old. She said, why Sarah say that she's old, she cannot have kids? Hashem changed the words of Sarah. Why? One way, you will come to the husband and say your wife thinks you old and will hurt him. So from here we learn that to prevent problems and fights and not to instigate between people, you can change what was said. What did they say about me? Don't worry, only good things. Only good things. You don't say, oh, she says stingy, you tough, you check the credit card bill every 2 hours. No, you don't tell him that. Oh, I only say the truth. You say the truth and you destroy the house. How is your truth gonna help that there will be divorce now with kids on the street? You have to use your head. Also to save someone's life. If you say the truth, they'll kill him. Tell me, did he do that? No. You sure? No, I was here, he didn't do it. Well, if you say yes, they're gonna chop his head off, the Romans. They're asking you now, what are you gonna say, yes? You're gonna make them kill him? They have to say no. Why, if you say yes, they'll kill him. You have to save life. Pikuach nefesh, doche Shabbat, doche Kippur, doche lies. Eliminate Shabbat, eliminate Kippur, eliminate lies as well. Why? It's a life risk. Only three things are not being eliminated. You have to die not to do it. Idol worshipping, gilui arayot, and murdering someone else. Those are the only three things. You have to die, say Shema Yisrael, and not agree to do. V'samachta b'chol ha'tov asher natan lecha Hashem Elokecha. It's when the people are getting good income, they are happy. After Sukkot, no more income. No more income. From now, there's not that much fruit left. There is still a little bit left until Chanukah, but Chanukah is already winter. By now, if there was fruit on the trees, it's all frozen and dead. So after Chanukah, no one brings a basket. Why? No income, no happiness. Remember this. We give sources here. It's not my personal opinions here. One more thing. ואמרת לפני השם, או, כי תחלה לעשר את כל מעשר תבואתך. Now the Torah talks about מעשר, 10%. When do you bring the מעשר to the Levi? In the third year. After the Shemitah, there is 1 year strike. You don't do anything in the field, you don't plant, you don't put water, you don't cut, you don't... Nothing. You leave it for the poor. The poor come, they take whatever they want for free, that's it. That's Shnat Shemitah. Every 7 years you have Shnat Shemitah, the year of Shemitah. After that, first year you bring Maaser Rishon, first year. And first 2 years you don't touch the fruits, the growth. You give it, Shnat, in the first year, the Torah gives us a cycle. The third year and the sixth year, it's called Maaser Ani. That he brings it to Yerushalayim and you give it. The first one, the first year, what do you do with the Maaser? You come, you give it as a gift to the Levi. Why? But you don't, it's not that you gave him a gift, you owe him that. It's a payment. It's like when you buy something, you give a payment. What does it mean you owe him that? The Levi is serving in Beit HaMikdash. The Levis are praying, the Levis are singing, the Levis are doing all the ceremonies in Beit HaMikdash. The Levis did not get a land in the land of Israel. They put them in Area Leviim, in different isolated cities, and they don't have their own territory like every tribe, and they also live among the murderers in the shelter cities. So the Levi is neglected when it comes to having his own land, his own piece of land. And they also serve you when you come to Beit HaMikdash. Without them you couldn't do anything. So you owe them. So the first year the Maaser goes to the Levi. That's what you owe him. You're not doing him a favor. Maaser Sheni. You go to Yerushalayim and you eat it yourself. You cannot eat it where you live. You have to go to Yerushalayim and you eat it. So you benefit from it. So you're not doing anyone a favor. So first year, it's a payment. Second year, you eat it. Third year, it's a different story. You give it to the poor people, people that are needy. That's why it's called Maaser. It's called Shnat HaMaaser. So the third and the sixth year, that's when it counts like a big mitzvah for you of charity. Because the first year you are obligated. But although you are obligated to support the Leviim, Shevet Levi was in Mitzrayim, the one that learned Torah, that did not work in slavery. The Leviim are responsible on the Torah learning. Everything the Leviim do, you get a credit for it. Why? Because you support them financially. It's written that Hashem told Moshe to teach the Leviim what they have to do in Beit HaMikdash. And after that, it's written, everything, Vayasu Bnei Israel, and the nation of Israel did, as Hashem commanded Moshe to do. But that was only for the Leviim, not for the nation of Israel. But the Torah gives credit like the entire nation of Israel did it. The Mefarshim say, because when you support someone that learns Torah, he learns Torah and he gets full credit, and you get full credit because you sponsor the Bachur Yeshiva. While he's learning thanks to your money, you and him, both of you, benefits from the huge reward of learning Torah. When you sponsor Kiruv, the rabbi that makes people become religious, couldn't do it without your money. Couldn't do it without your support. Without you support CDs and USBs and books and flights and seminars and lots of other things. Without your money, none of that would be done. Therefore, now you have a stock in all these activities. Wonderful investment. Depend on how much money you give. Obviously, if you give 1,000 or you give 10,000, when you give 10,000, you get 10 times more. It's like stocks. You own 10 stocks or you own 100 stocks? Depend on how much you give. If you give $2 a month, how much is going to give you? How much $2? They don't buy even one USB. What are you gonna do with $2? There's nothing you can do. What do you buy, napkins? It has to be realistic. If your donation is substantial enough that you can buy things and give it to people and make them religious, that alone could be a wonderful thing. Sometimes it's a one-time large investment and you collect on it for eternity. Collect on it for eternity. Give you an example. I had one time a guy, I wanted to put him in yeshiva. I met him in Queens Boulevard. Long story, Israeli, walked around, didn't know what to do with his life, was probably 23 years old, 22 maybe, Yemenite guy. I said to him, I'll take you to the yeshiva, come to Monsi, see what is the Torah, וזה. I said, I'm not, you know, I'm not religious, וזה. Anyway, I owe my roommate 2 months rent, and I have a few bills that I didn't pay, I'm looking for a job. I say, how much you owe? I say, almost $3,000. It's 2 months of rent and few bills. I'm in a minus $3,000. I called one rich guy. I told him, you have an opportunity of a lifetime. I spoke to that guy. I said, if I get you the money to pay the rent, to pay your roommates, to pay all your debt, you clean, you don't owe anything. Will you come to the yeshiva and you sit 1 year and learn Torah? You have everything there, food, room, great friends, place is nice. He just thought about how will he pay the 3,000 20 years ago was like 10,000 today. Don't get mistaken. This is the value of the money. 20 years ago, 3,000 was a lot of money. But for the rich guy, it was nothing. So I said to him, you have an opportunity. One investment, 1 year of Torah comes to your account for $3,000. This guy commit to sit 1 year. What do you think happened? This guy until today learned, and he has 10 kids, they're all in Talmudet Torah. He's a huge Talmid Chacham. He walks in the street, he takes off his reading glasses. His glasses not to see, not modest things on the street. He became a super, super fanatic holy guy. For 20 years he learned Torah, and that rich guy for $3,000, he should kiss my feet 1,000,000 times a second. For eternity, for giving him such an investment. But he was smart to give the money. Do you know how many trillions of mitzvot he already got for that $3,000? He cannot count. All the Torah that the children of this guy is learning now in Israel goes to his account. Another few years he will have grandkids in Talmud Torah, maybe already have, I don't know. Goes to his account. 20 years from now, he will have grandchildren, goes to his account. Just for that, it was worth it for him to come to the world, to invest that $3,000 in this chiloni. What can be greater than this? Think for a second, think. There's no better investment than this in the history of the world. You have to be smart. You have to know where to invest. There are some people, you give them 10 years money, they won't make one Baal Tshuva. Why? Their style is very parv. Very, very soft. Soft approach does not do anything effective. Nothing. You may get lucky once a year, someone that is very hungry for Judaism will come on his own to beg to become religious. No, maybe. Maybe. But someone who didn't have plans to become religious with soft approach, you think he's going to give up all his fantasies and agree to become a learner of Torah and come to shul in the morning? Or where are you? You're living in a dream. It will never happen. The only way it will happen is a combination of transferring a lot of convincing knowledge that the Torah is divine and there is a God and he's watching him and everything is recorded, and to make him understand that every minute of his life will be judged, for good or for bad. He will must be dealing with the consequences of his sins and of his good deeds. Sooner or later, he won't be able to avoid it. Once he gets this understanding, you don't need to beg him anymore to keep mitzvot. He's already afraid enough not to be wicked. And if he had a weak moment that he broke the laws of the Torah, immediately, shortly after, he will repent. He doesn't need you to be his babysitter. Why? Because you put the right ideology into, you injected the right venom into his system. All these power of things, trust me, from 30 years of experience, it's called in Hebrew, kosot ruach lemet. You know how you go to the Chinese people and you have back pain and they have these glasses, they put fire on the back and they suck out the air from the system? You know how you have round things on the back? Did you ever do it or no? That's called kosot ruach. Glasses of spirit. Takes out the air out of the body. Will you do it to a dead body? Person that had back pain, he came to you and say, can you take out the pain out of my back, Mr. Lee? Sure, sure. Lay down, oh, he got a heart attack and died. He's dead now. They're waiting for Chevrat Kadisha to come take him. So the Chinese continue with his glass. What are you doing, Mr. Lee? He gave me money to do kosot ruach. So you're normal, he's dead already. What is it going to help? That's called Pav Shita. Soft approach. Complete waste of time. Trust me when I tell you. Complete waste of time. Not only it's waste of time, in most cases it makes damage. Coming to wicked people and tell them God loves you as you are, unconditionally, don't worry. All Jews go to heaven. There's no such thing punishment. That's a huge crime. Huge crime. Worse than lechalel Shabbat. Worse. Worse than to eat on Yom Kippur. Worse sometimes than to murder someone. Because you are now murdering a soul for eternity. You are the reason why this chiloni, this secular die, will die chiloni. Because you came to him and tell him with your nice beard and your nice sombrero, don't worry, there's no such thing, wicked Jews. Hashem loves everyone equally. They're all his children. He loves the criminal, he loves the murderers, he loves the gays, he loves the mechalele Shabbat, he loves Madoff, the thief that make thousands of families lose everything they have. He loves the Nazis, he loves the Hamas, the Hezbollah. He loves Hussein Obama, Bernie Sanders, Yimach Shimo. He loves all of them. Such a scam, such filth to even say such thing. Forget about the stupidity behind it. How you can lose everything in a minute. He's not responsible to what he's doing. Hashem will understand him. You know it for sure. Will you sign your life on it? You sign your life on it? Hold the Torah and swear that Hashem will forgive this chiloni for being mechalel Shabbat. If you do it, I keep my mouth shut. All of them are liars. You put them on a lie detector and you see they don't believe what they say. They know they're going to be punished. Why they tell them Hashem loves you? Because it triples the donation. It's going to give him three times more because it makes him feel good. Come, put tefillin, don't want. But I'm mechalel Shabbat. No. Hashem loves you. It's not, but it's written. I heard the other rabbi say that Mechalel Shabbat will be cut permanently. Don't listen to him. It's not the right way. That's not how you teach Torah. Ma, it's not written in the Torah. No, no, ma. But it's written. But he will lie that it's not written. Why? It will defeat his agenda. He wants to be popular. When you tell people wonderful things about themselves, they enjoy to come. You tell jokes, they enjoy to come. You tell them God loves you. One mitzvah here you keep, you're already big tzaddik. You're greater than a Baba Sali. Of course he will come. It's like a psychology therapy. You make him feel great about his sins. But when he comes to me, I make him leave the lecture with a horrible feeling, guilty feelings. I better wake up. I better stop stealing. I better stop with my Lashon Hara. I better change my alfetz. That should be more modest if it's a woman. I better be more strict about Shabbat. What is this? I better, he goes out with 20, 30 different things that right now is disturbed about. What happened, Moshe? You look like you became green. Don't ask. I went to this lecture. Whew. I almost got a heart attack. Everything he spoke about, he was reading verses from the Torah, It's me. Talks about Goya girlfriend. It's me. חלל שבת. It's me. Eating on Yom Kippur. It's me. לשון הרע all day. It's me. Not praying. It's me. Not putting tefillin. It's me. Everything he spoke today for 2 hours, everything he said I'm guilty of. But today I understood that there is a massive price to what I'm doing. Until now, nobody ever told me that I'm going to have to pay the bill. I thought it's for free to be mechalel Shabbat. Do what you like. Be happy. Think positive, it will be positive. You know all these statements that people make that have no connection to Judaism whatsoever? You murder people every day and you think positive and it will be positive? You're going to murder people every day, but you think positive. You think that you're great. You think that God loves you. You're not going to have to pay for everyone you murder? You really believe that nonsense? Believe it or not, some people believe this nonsense. Most people know it's fake. They know it, Rabotai. Most people know. So, Rabotai, ואמרת לפני השם אלוקיך, you say in front of your God, בנג'י, איפה בנג'י? It's too hot here. And you say in front of your God, I took all the holy fruits out of the house. What does it mean, holy fruit? Fruits that belongs to the Beit HaMikdash, they go to high cause, they consider holy. And I also gave it to the Levi, and to the converts, and to the orphans, and to the widows. What's mutual to 4 different kinds of people? Levi, converts, orphans, and widows. What's the mutual common denominator between those 4? All of them are needy. They are not independently financially stable. The Levi is busy all day in Beit HaMikdash, working, serving. There's no time to go open a business. He needs your 10%, as we mentioned before. Orphans, they don't have a father to support them. The community has to take care of them. Widows, same thing. She doesn't have a husband. It's not enough for her to raise 10 kids on her own. She needs help. Converts, they don't barely know the language. They don't know. They just came to the community. They're learning. They need you to support them. They need places to eat on Shabbat, on Yom Tov. They need someone to teach them how to pray in a shul. They hold the siddur upside down. How can you ignore? Oh, if a convert needs help, you have to help him. You cannot ignore him. You have to love him. You should know when you give a charity to a Jew from birth, mitzvah ma'atorah, big mitzvah. If he's a learner of Torah, huge mitzvah. If he's also a convert, you have to have in mind not just to support the poor, not just to support a bachur yeshiva that learns Torah and makes Hashem happy, you also have to have in mind to fulfill the mitzvah of loving the ger, the convert. You are getting 2 credits here, 3. 1, helping a poor. 2, supporting Torah. 3, supporting a convert. When you give a Jew from birth, you have only 2 credits. He's not a convert. But when he's also a convert, he was born a goy and became a Jew, now you have in mind also, it's written 36 times in the Torah, to love the converts, to help them, not to deceive them, etc. And this is very good. So for instance, if you have 2 Talmidei Chachamim, they bought poor in yeshiva, and you want to sponsor one of them for the whole month, and now you found out that Reuven is Jewish from birth, and this guy is a convert of few years old, who you should give the money to as a priority? To the convert. Now you got 3 credits instead of 2. Plus, is more needy than the Jew from birth. Jew from birth have uncles, cousins, parents. There are people to help him. They won't neglect their own blood. These converts have no one in the world. Who is he gonna go? Help me out. Who are you? Do I know you? How do I know you're even Jewish? If you know, you have to make sure that they have what they need. Same thing, orphans, and same thing, the widows. And definitely you don't mess with them. You don't torture them. You don't make them upset. If they cry and scream to Hashem, that's the end of you. It's a clear verse in the Torah. Hashem promised, if the widows and the orphans and all this needy group of people scream to me, I will listen to their scream. I don't want to say the rest of what's going to happen to you. You got to be very careful, Rabotai. You do not mess with orphans and widows and converts. You don't mess with them. What happened if you just found out that this convert is a real convert, he converted, he keeps mitzvot, but he's a terrible crook. Thief, liar, crook. He just misled you all alone. You supported him, you helped him, you did, and now you found out that this guy is a sleazy thief. Still like he used to be in a goy. He's a Jew now. The Bedin converted him. What happened now? It's a big problem. You're allowed to help the thief? You have to warn the people from the thief. You have to stay away from liars and crooks and thieves and deceivers. It's a big dilemma. What do you do, Rabotai? Sometimes the questions have sides for good and for bad on both sides. What do you do? You have sides to neglect him and you have side to continue to support him. What do? You go to a chacham, to a big chacham, big rabbi. Rabbi, I have a dilemma. I was helping this guy, inviting him, helping him, giving him, buying him. I just found out he's a scam. Should I continue to invite him? Yes or no? If not, should I warn the community from him? I don't want other people to be his victims. If I won, then the people will turn their back on him and maybe we're making Hashem angry because he's a convert. You know, are we doing good or bad? Are you allowed to defend a convert that is a thief and going to Jews and steal from them or take advantage on them? Forgery? Of course not. Lo ta'amod al dam recha. Convert has a limit to how much you're going to help him. If you find out he's a pedophile, you're going to help him to take advantage on kids in the neighborhood? Of course not. So even that has a limit. If the widow is a serial killer, you're going to help her because she's a widow? Of course not. If he's mechalel Shabbat liar, you're going to help him? You're going to give him aliyot? No. Oh, but he's a convert. But he's a mechalel Shabbat. No, he counts like a goy. Every mechalel Shabbat counts like a goy. But he's punished like a Jew. Before he converted, he could have break Shabbat as much as he wanted. He wasn't obligated to keep. Now when he converted to Judaism in a kosher bed din and became Jewish, and now he breaks Shabbat, now you cannot give him aliyah anymore because he's mechalel Shabbat. But he's being fully punished for breaking Shabbat. What if? If he's a pedophile, you have to warn the whole community from him. The Benin has to put notes with his pictures everywhere. Today with the internet, they have to publish a warning that people should be careful from this person that was already caught messing up with kids. Everyone should be warned from this person, not to bring them into their house, not to let their children near him. The greater of the good, of the greater, the public, overcome the good of the individual. If the individual is a threat to the public, you have to warn the public from the individual. You understand? If the public is a threat to the individual, is innocent tzaddik, and the public is wicked, you have to warn the individual from the public. Either way, you have to warn the victim from the predator. This is what the Torah said. Lo ta'amod al dam reicha. Now, Rabotai, Rav Yitzchak Abarbanel, he lived in Inquisition of Spain in that time. 500 years ago. He said, there's no mitzvah that a person has to confess that he finished to do the mitzvah. Only this, Bikurim. You put tefillin, you have to make a declaration, I just put tefillin, God, I listened to what you told me to do? No. You did kiddush, you have to say after that, Hashem, I did what you say to me to be mekadesh the Shabbat? No. Every mitzvah you do, you don't have to announce, Hashem, I just did what you told me. I didn't move left or right from what you commanded me. Accept this mitzvah. Why? Why after you bring the first fruits that grew in your field, you finish to give it to the Kohen, you say, Hashem, I did as you ordered me, I did not neglect anything from your command. What is this? Has to be a reason. What do you think? Rav Yitzchak Abarbanel explained, he says, the ma'aser is mamon she'en lo tovim. When you owe money, Reuven owe money to Shimon. Shimon demands his money back. You're not doing anyone a favor. You have to pay back what you took. When you have ma'aser, there is no one specific that has ownership on this money. It's right now your money and you must get rid of it. You have to give it out. But who to give it out, it's your choice. So if a Levi come to you and say, you owe me the ma'aser, you have ma'aser, no? Give it to me, I'm a Levi. So yes, I will give it, but not to you, to Shimon Levi. You Reuven Levi, I'm not giving it to you. I'll give it to your cousin, Shimon Levi. Shimon comes, I heard you want to give me ma'aser. No, I didn't mean you, I didn't mean you. There's different Shimon Levi. The whole tribes, they are Levim. So every Levi that comes, so of course I will give, but not to you. Can he take you to Beit Din? No. Do you owe him anything? To him specifically. You owe the Levim the Maaser. But which one? You have the right to decide. So no one can take you to Beit Din and take it out of you by force. If someone borrowed money from you, you can take him to court and get the money out of him by force. Because he owe you the money. But if you have to give charity, you have the right to decide where to give. Of course, you have to be smart and to give it to the most righteous person and the one who learns the most Torah, the one that does the most kiruv, that's where you have to give. You don't want to give someone that is barely Shomer Shabbat or someone that barely opens a Gemara once a week, not even. You try to give it to the holiest person. Why? The more mitzvot he does, thanks to your food that you gave him, wheat, barley, thanks to that he makes chalot for Shabbat, for Yom Tov, he's eating well, he's learning well. Thanks to you, you get more income. You give it to some bum who plays sheshbesh in the street all day. He's a Levi, but he plays all day, play cards. Or Ocean Parkway, he played chess in Ocean Parkway there in the benches in Brooklyn. What mitzvah are you going to get from giving him money? You give it to Bachur Yeshiva Tzadik that learns Torah all day, you're very lucky. Your account is becoming bigger by the minute. But still, which Bachur Yeshiva? Nobody can force you. Which rabbi to give it to? Nobody can force you. Which synagogue to give it to? Nobody can force you. Which Levi to give it to? Nobody can force you. Because there is no one specific that can claim this money, the Yetzer Hara very easily, the Satan, convince you never to give the money. Delay and delay and delay until you forget. You know how many times people call me after a year, two, 3 years, Rabbi, I just heard your lecture, wow, I had money that I needed to give already 3 years ago. And, you know, again, I delayed it and delayed and delayed and delayed and I never gave it. Now I don't even remember how much it was. What should I do? That's what happens. Why he delayed it? If he owed money to someone specific, you cannot delay it 3 years if you have the money. But when you don't have someone specific in mind that you are obligated to give to, then the Yetzer Hara will make sure you never give it to anyone. That's why I always tell people, don't give donation one at a time. Because the Yetzer Hara will make you always forget. Tomorrow, 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 next week, in the end, 2 months, 5 months, 6 months, you give nothing. Make monthly automatic recurring donation. Tak, you put it once, automatic it comes out every month. That's a part of your maaser. Like this, the mitzvah gets done. If you have to count on you remembering to do it and to have the time to do, you know how many times I have things to do during the day, I say, okay, let me do it in a minute, I finish this. The next day I remember, whoa, I didn't do it. Till how many, in 1 second you forget. The Gemara said that, what period is the minimal period for a person to forget what he has to do? The minimal piece of time. What is it, a minute, 30 seconds, 5 minutes? How long is the minimum that it takes for a person to be able to forget what he was about to do? The Gemara say, toch kede dibur. While you're speaking about, I'm going to do it now, before you finish the sentence, you can forget already what. You know why? There was a beep on the window now. Whoop! You looked, you already forgot. Someone knocked on the door. You went to open the door, you already forgot what you were doing. You're about to answer an email, you forgot about it. A week later, you say, oh, I never answered this guy. Did I answer? Did I not? You don't remember anymore. Toch kede dibur, meaning in a second, you can forget. In 1 second. That's why a kosher person should make a diary. Everything he writes, you owe money to someone, you bought something, immediately you write in your phone or in your notebook, I owe money to this person, I have to pay it by this date. And every day you check the list. What things to do? I have a list here, things to do. Everything I do, delete from the list. Check it out, it goes out. This guy ordered tefillin, I have to deliver. This guy, mezuzot, Monday, bring with you mezuzot to the shiur. I write, telephone number, person, otherwise how can you remember thousands of details? This one, shiur over here, make a flyer, do this, send that, send, so many things, besides your personal stuff. What you have to do at work, what you have to do with your customer, you have to be organized. Being organized saves you a lot of problem and money waste in life. Sometimes can save your life, literally. Literally. Or when you hear a lecture, pause it, immediately write down what you just heard. The source. Why? Later on, you're not going to remember where it is in the lecture. It'll take you an hour to look for it. Right now, pause it, write it down. You have to have a notebook with Chilushei Torah. Wow, where did it say? Gemara, Masechet Ketubot, you write it down. Slowly, slowly, after a while, you have a lot of things. You want to know where it is? It's all written. You have to be organized, Rabotai. You learn Gemara, you write on the side comments. Make sure you write. Why? Otherwise, you won't remember. So you have to make a decision who you want to give your maaser and make sure it's done automatically. When you remember, when you don't remember. Some people have these checks that goes automatically weekly. Weekly, they come automatically from the bank. You see, a bank check every week comes. Why? They know what's their weekly salary. They calculate the maaser. Every week, a check comes by mail, $70, boom. Next week, $70. Why? Probably makes them $800. That's the maaser. Organized people. Other people, they are messy. They may give 1 day more, and sometimes they'll give less. 1 month they may give 13%, a month or two later they give 5%. And then you ask them, can you swear that this year you gave maaser? I hope so. You hope so? You want to steal from Hashem? What do you mean you hope so? You buy Aliyah in Shul. You come Motzei Shabbat, immediately you write down the date, what synagogue, you may be a guest there, you went to someone for Shabbat, they gave you Aliyah, you make a neder that you make a donation to the shul. Immediately, Motzei Shabbat, you come to the Gabbai, you write down his telephone number, how do I give you the money? A week later, you won't remember that you were in Brooklyn last Shabbat. You won't remember how much was the pledge, what was it, 101, 126, 180, I don't remember. We forget things within minutes. A week later, you think you will remember? Do you know why you forget? Because it's not important in your eyes. You don't forget the date of your wedding, right? You waited for that years. Nobody has to remind you when you're getting married. If someone has to remind you that, oy vey to your wife, to your future wife. We're finishing here, Rabotai, for today. Bezrat Hashem, I didn't speak about the curses today, but tomorrow I want to go over some, not all, the meaning of those curses. How do they apply to us? We need to know what it means, and in what scenario they can be, chas v'shalom, God forbid, applied to every one of us. Why we need to know? To make sure not to do what the Torah says, not to do that will bring the curse. I many times told you, if a chacham curse you, don't sleep a month. Wow, this rabbi got angry at me. You have to see how he spoke to me. Yeah, I'm so worried now. You should be worried. But here is Hashem cursing you. You worry about the rabbi. You have to start waking up. If there are things in the Torah that say that someone that does it, immediately is cursed. Immediately, automatically. Hashem doesn't have to say, Mr. X from now on is cursed. No. Soon as he did it, curse comes on him, to his life. Affect his children, affect his house, affect everything in his life. Immediately becomes cursed. Who wants to be cursed by Hashem every day of his life? Raise his hand. Nobody? How come? No, let's see who's brave. Nobody. If I offer you now $1,000, would you raise your hand? No. 10,000? No. 100,000?
$1,000,000 is...
You want to be cursed by Hashem for $1,000,000? Do you know what it means to be cursed by Hashem?
No.
I tell you what it means. You were supposed to have the best shidduch, get married, have wonderful kids. You become cursed, you die lonely. You have no kids, no nothing. It's worth it for $1,000,000 to get such a curse.
I don't have a shidduch.
I'm just saying. Curse means that you were supposed to get something unbelievable that will make every moment of your life happy and will affect you for eternity after life. And God forbid the curse hit on the person and he lost this blessing that Hashem wanted to give him. That's called a curse. A curse makes a person not get what Hashem wanted to give him. Because Hashem wants to give every person a lot of good. Why sometimes he doesn't give a person the good? Only because the Satan comes to object. And the Satan comes to object when he has a strong case. If he doesn't have a strong case, you know.
Okay, but my cousin, she's secular Jewish, and she's getting engaged to be married, and I'm more observant, but I'm single.
Oh.
I don't get it.
First of all, who said that to get married is a blessing always? Some people, from the minute they got married, their life was destroyed. Do you know what a witch they got? They begged the day that they were single. So not, to get married, when I say to get married, I mean holy house, kosher spouse, kosher kids, holiness in the house. For that, it's worth it.
I mean romance and love, that kind of...
Romance and love, by the secular people, it's all desire. You want to get the proof for that? I'll give you the proof. Check every secular couple that you ever heard about that got married. How they were lovey-dovey, mootsy-pootsy before the wedding, come 6 months after and see how they behave to each other. If you will find one couple that hug and love each other the same exact way like before, a day before the wedding, I'll give you a huge prize.
Okay, I know.
Rega! Rega, wait. That's 6 months after the wedding. Come 6 years after the wedding and see how many times the police came there. And how many windows are broken and how many curses were in that house. You know why? Not because they are bad people. Because when you don't have God in a house, God said, this house will never have a blessing in it. Love, a lot of people make mistake between love and desire. Love in Hebrew, it's ahava. Lust, desire, it's ta'ava. It sounds almost the same. Ahava, ta'ava. But what's the difference? Ahava starts with Aleph, the first letter in the alphabet. Tava starts with Taf, the last letter in the alphabet. Why they are sound exactly the same? It's rhymed. Why? Because they feel very much alike. Love, real love, and lust, meaning desire, in the beginning feels very much alike. All day you think about it, you cannot get it out of your head. But after a while, you're going to see if it was real love or it was just desire. Why? Because a real love is not something that depends on something materialistic. That means a spiritual connection. Every love that it depends on something, meaning her beauty, her weight, her body, her clothing, her money, her job, whatever the case may be, once that something is gone or changed, immediately the connection is broken. From then on, there's no relationship. Real love between people, meaning that if Chas v'Shalom, the man will become paralyzed and he's in bed and he's totally worthless and he cannot do anything and he cannot be with her, cannot buy her, he's a needy, she has to change his diaper, she has to take care of him for 20 years and she gives her life for him and she loves him just like she loved him when he was a macho man. How many relationships like this you know? Most of the relationships is, what can I get from you? That's what she thinks, and that's what he thinks. But the problem is that that's something that I can get from her, or what she can get from me, will not always remain around. And therefore, when the ability to give that something will be gone, the relationship in a minute will be over. That's why when the excitement is gone, all the problems begin, and the cheating, and the divorce, and the court, and police, and lawsuits, and custody battles. Why is it? Because everything was built on desire. She was pretty, and skinny, and young. 20 years later, she's not exactly what she was 20 years ago. All that desire that attracted him to her is gone. There is no connection between him and her. He can look at her. He cannot stand there. She makes a soup, he complains. 20 years ago, he licked his fingers. It wasn't about the soup. 20 years ago, he was desiring her all the time. Now he doesn't desire her. Now everything she does is annoying. Everything. 20 years ago, everything she did, no matter how bad it was wonderful. Wow, it's so great. Do you understand how it works? I have full lectures about this. It's not the topic now. Tomorrow I'll continue in Brooklyn, Be'ezrat Hashem. Baruch Adonai le'olam. Amen ve'amen.
Amen.
Thank you.